Today's sponsor of the Vision Quest podcast is 920 Hat Company. Leather patch hats are in, and 920 Hat Company is here to hook you up with your very own custom hat. All patches are lasered on top-grade genuine leather and on popular brand hats like Richardson and FlexFit. Whether you're looking to show off your business or want a one-of-a-kind hat for yourself, 920 Hat Company can do it all. All the hats are handcrafted right in the Fox Valley, but worn across America. With over 500 hats in stock, they guarantee fast turnaround times. Honestly, Liam, you know, looking at these hats, solid, right?
Yeah, they're pretty, I like them.
I like that patch, itself.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, one-of-a-kind stuff. I know his name's Trevor. He does great work. He's actually gotten what? I think we got a knit hat coming.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, we got that coming. So we're really excited to have these guys on board as a sponsor. So get down to check them out on Facebook. I believe they're on Instagram. Check them out, man. They got the best hats, I think, in the Fox Valley, if not in the state.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. So get down to 920 Hat Company on social media and check them out. Now I did. Joined today, finally, with my co-host, Liam Crook. I am Brad Crook. We are the Vision Quest podcast. And today, we have probably an honorary member. You'll just be like one of the guys that if you're out there, you're the dude that is representing. Because we have Frank Jasper. Shute, a.k.a. Shute from the Vision Quest movie, man. The namesake of the show. So, I'm going to start out just by asking, number one, how old were you when the movie was put out?
So I was just turning 26. Matthew was 26.
Okay.
And Linda Fiorentino was 27. So she was only 1 year older than us. And both Matthew and I think looked younger than our age.
Totally. Yeah. You guys played the roles really well. So now going from there, we're going to go back to the beginning. You didn't come from wrestling, huh?
No, I wrestled.
You did?
I in high school.
Okay.
Yeah, I wrestled in high school 3 years.
Okay.
If I go back further, where it all came from really is my dad was a black belt in judo. He got his black belt while he was serving in Japan.
Wow.
And so he was one of the few white guys that was allowed in the dojo over there.
I get it.
The Japanese were very specific about who they let in, and then they would beat the crap out of them because they wanted to make sure that they knew what judo was really about, true judo.
Yeah.
So my dad studied over there, and he brought it back to the United States. And when I was in third or fourth grade, my dad was an iron worker, 30-plus years.
Nice.
And so during that time, some of his coworkers were like, hey, we want to learn some self-defense and we would love to take a class. So my dad created a class. And so like third, fourth grade, we learned how to throw. We learned how to roll. We learned how to land, to take a nice slap. So you take care of yourself.
Yeah.
And there was some ground wrestling.
Okay.
So a couple of really cool techniques that I still use that still work in the wrestling community.
Okay.
You just cannot get out of them. They're wrestling technique holds.
That's crazy.
So it all started back then.
So all these huge.
And I was always into martial arts.
Okay.
So,
okay.
You know, everybody loves Bruce Lee, and I was very much into Japanese and the Bushido and understanding of martial arts.
Okay.
And there was a Shogun series that I absolutely watched. I read the books. I loved the whole concept that if you were a healer or a martial artist, you also needed to learn how to heal. So that was also an understanding.
Yeah.
So I have all of these things in my background.
Wow.
And a matter of fact, I ended up going to an acupuncture school, university at one point. I got a master's degree in oriental medicine.
Holy cow.
For the last 27 years, my wife and I ran a clinic in Pacific Palisades.
Holy cow, man.
Yeah. And so 2 years ago, we moved to Carmel. So I'm continuing what I do, but I've kind of focused more on nutrition now.
Okay.
And I'm actually dedicated to bringing in healthy nutrition and a healthy way to cut weight in the wrestling community. There is a way to do this appropriately. I mean, there's a way to do it.
Yes.
In which you don't suffer from the loss of strength, endurance, and have to overtrain for events.
I have a whole other episode that I'm going to do with you then, because I'm looking for a nutritionist. I'm looking for guys that, especially within the wrestling, where you could talk to a nutritionist and be like, oh, you need to eat healthy. Yeah. These guys are different, well, you know?
A little over 2 years ago, Nick Sirianni and his family came into my office in Pacific Palisades.
Sick.
You guys know who Nick Sirianni is?
No, never heard of him. I don't know about that crazy guy.
Didn't he wrestle like Dayton Fix?
He wrestled, probably. I don't know. I don't know if he won national championships. Yeah. Nice.
So, anyway, he came in. We hit it off. He asked me to work with him. And so for the last 2 years plus, I've been working with him, and we had prepped him for the Big Ten this last year, which he completely dominated.
Totally.
And then he went into the NCAAs, and even in the final, the guy didn't even score any points.
So they're all
penalty points.
So then was – obviously he probably knew at the beginning of the season, seeing the guys – he knew he was going to do well, but – were like his coaches and you very keen on him staying on like the direct path, or did you guys let him kind of like
choose his own direction?
Yeah, have like a cheat day or something like that.
We dial in everything he puts in his mouth.
Okay, and wow.
And so one of the things I have the ability to do is I have I do what's called O-ring muscle testing. It's applied kinesiology. It's a way for me to work with people from a distance and get very accurate testing results. And so we would go, what is he going to do 30 minutes out? What is he going to do an hour out? What's he going to do 45 minutes out? This is the product he's going to take. Then he's going to have this one. Then he's going to have this one. And then right before the match, he's going to take this.
We're going to be in touch. We're going to be in touch.
Yeah, lots to talk about.
That's for sure. Not only just that, but like for him, because that's, I mean, nutrition and things like that. To talk about a leg up in the game. So that's an intricate part of what you're doing right now. But so coming up with your dad teaching judo, especially to these strong ass iron workers, and then you give them that deadly combination of judo and just kick ass. I mean, you must have been surrounded by some guys that were just ready to roll and good practice partners and things like that to be able to kind of hone things in. Where did you, after, you know, with your dad doing that, where did that take you then? Were you competing in judo?
Not at all. I lived in a small town. It was Nez Perce, Idaho. Population 555 people.
Okay. Yep. Yep.
So super small.
Yeah.
And little farming community.
Yep. Okay, and that's where that's kind of like my wife is from in Niagara, up in northern Wisconsin. Very, very small paper mill community. Yep.
So I basically use that to take care of myself, protect my brother against the bullies that were in our class. That's where it really came in. Yeah. That's where that advantage, knowledge, leverage, being able to throw somebody that's much bigger than you.
Sure.
All of that really paid off when I got jumped by some of the bigger guys. Listen, I got to tell you, I know that in the movie, there's this beast that shows up carrying a log.
Yeah.
But when I was little, I was little.
Sure.
I was super small.
Yeah.
Like I went through, when I finished eighth grade, I was 5'4", 104 pounds.
Oh, you were small. Yeah. Yeah,
right on. And so as a freshman, I wrestled at 112 to 115.
Okay. How'd you do? Well, with your judo?
Not good.
No?
I mean, I did a little okay. I did okay in a tournament here or there.
Okay.
You know how this goes.
Yeah.
When you're learning how to wrestle. I just got exposed to it for the very first time as a freshman.
Sure.
And in the first year, you're just trying to figure things out. You're just trying to
Yep.
But, you know. Second, third year is when you really kind of start to here's a counter. Here's the counter to the counter. Here's what I'm going to attack with. This is what I'm going
to
start to figure things out. But nowadays, these kids wrestle year round. I mean, we got exposed just a short time and that was it. And then on to the next sport.
Yeah, so totally.
Nowadays, these guys are killers.
They got things everywhere.
Eighth grade.
They got tournaments everywhere. I mean, we're talking Tulsa to everywhere. And we talk about that almost every episode where I remember just only – because I wasn't as good as my brother in wrestling, but those guys only went to one Iowa tournament. That's all you heard about. You know, they went to Iowa one time a year and they were good. And these, like, we're all over the country. We're in Pennsylvania. We're in Virginia. We're everywhere. So yeah, totally. I can totally feel what you're talking about when it comes to just the amount of exposure to now is just crazy.
So, and now they've got all these guys where you can go and you can take, you know, seminars and clinics and, you know, you're seeing stuff that's like amazing.
Right.
And it's evolved. I mean, things have evolved now.
Big time. Big time.
Crazy what these kids can do now.
Anyway, that's kind of what we talk about too, is I think it's a big question I have is how much more could the sport actually evolve? You know, I mean, as far it moves our moves and we have, you know, if you see a few new ones, and obviously Askren brought in the whole funk thing, and just the change of the pace of wrestling now is harder. Heavyweights don't wrestle the same, you know, it's all kind of just changing. So it's like, God, what more could happen in the sport itself as far as evolution and dieting and working out is the next one I'm seeing as far as guys taking care of themselves. Cause then if every guy does that, I just can only imagine the type of competition we're going to see on a mat. You know, it's just going to be crazy.
So here's my, just, I'm going to give you a quick hit on this.
Yeah.
A lot of these guys, they think that they've got to like cut all their, you know, they've got to like dehydrate their bodies. They've got to, carb load before the matches. Well, I'm going to tell you this. Anytime you start to carb load for a match, you're going to spike and you're going to crash.
Yep.
So you better pin it in the first or the second round at the latest. Otherwise you can, a third round, somebody's a grinder. You're going to die. You're going to gas out.
Yep.
And I, the last thing I want to hear anymore. And I've been to a few appearances and this kid was like, oh, I've had 3 almonds today. It's like, that's, and you're in a tournament.
Not good.
How do you expect yourself to wrestle through a tournament? And then another guy's, a father came up to me and goes, we've been really working on his cardio, but he just gassed out. And it's like, well, because you just dehydrated him. You just, took away all his nutrients and you overtrained him. Yeah. And now you expect him to wrestle in a tournament because you just, exhausted him.
Yep.
The Russians, they eat into their matches.
Really?
So that means they are down low enough where they're eating before, several hours before they're loading up.
Yeah.
They're not gassing out and they're not dehydrated. And if you looked at Nick, you saw him, you saw Nick Siriano sweating on the mat. He was at 125 and he was sucked down because he won his first NCAA at 133.
Yep.
And he was overweight going into that at one point. He was sitting in a sauna at 10 pounds over.
He looked like a monster in that Michigan singlet. Like when I saw him compared to the year before, looking that transformation that he had was like, whoa, he's veiny, he's fit, he's like, looked like he was in super shape. And I was like, wow, had no idea he was doing stuff with you. That's awesome. That's really cool.
So if you look at him, you see that he had horsepower the whole way through there. And what we did is we're not into full ketosis. I don't like being in full ketosis 24 hours a day. I like being, intermittent fast in ketosis for a little bit, then back out of ketosis.
Yep.
And then there's a way you just limit your carbs because listen, you got two pathways of energy. You've got the ketosis where you're breaking down fat, the ketogenic pathway.
Yep.
And you got your glycogen pathway where you're breaking down carbs and sugars. And so most people rely on just the carbs and sugars and they don't teach their body.
Yeah.
So it's like, all you're going to do is you're just going to train your bicep, or you're not going to train your tricep.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're telling.
Yep.
So how are you going to like push up when you got no tricep?
Right. Correct.
Same concept with the energetics here. And so here's the other deal. If you are consuming carbohydrates prior to a match, you're actually going to spike your sugar. Then you're going to crash.
Yep.
And then if you have too much sugar in your system, now your body is going to have a flood of sugar and it's going to store it as fat, whatever it doesn't, get used. And then here's the other piece. When other parts that don't get used and that don't get stored as fat flow around the body, they're in the blood. So this sugar now is looking for receptor sites.
Yep.
Yep. The receptor sites that it looks for and wants to connect to are protein receptor sites. Those protein receptor sites are your muscles.
Holy cow.
That's where you're going to get those muscles. And when it makes a connection to those receptor sites, it creates what we call a rigid bond.
Okay.
So now you've got a rigid bond in your muscles. So now you don't have the flexibility and the strength to kind of like expand and contract.
Yep.
What happens is you get enough of those. We call them microadhesions. Mm-hmm. You get enough of those. Now, when you challenge the body, like at a plyometric, an explosive movement, it doesn't stretch and come back. It tears. And that's where you're setting yourself up for injury.
Yeah. A lot of that happening.
If you look around, and this is one of the things I noticed with our professional athletes.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of these guys are slamming Gatorades and things like that. Look at the sugar content.
It's
most of that high sugar content,
yep.
You know, minimum amounts of minerals. You got to be thinking about electrolytes. But
yeah,
that's interesting. I see a lot more of these professional athletes that are trained and look magnificent.
Yeah.
But they end up getting injured quite often.
Sure, sure.
Or tear something and they don't heal from it because they have way too much sugar going around in their systems.
Wow.
Like, I don't know if you heard some of these basketball players, they're doing Skittles and stuff like that before, like, a game. And
yeah.
Exactly why they're going to, and that also creates inflammation in the system. It feeds bacteria and viruses and suppresses your immune system and dysregulates your hormones. So why are we doing this?
So I'm going to have to.
We don't know, I guess.
Because I'm going to have.
We want to eat this.
I'm going to have to cut out Reese's peanut butter cups, you're saying, is what I'm going to have to do.
So you can do some hacks with stuff like that.
Sure.
I don't recommend those often, but every now and then.
Sure.
I'm down for dark chocolate.
Oh,
I'm down for small amounts of dark chocolate,
true.
85% or better.
Yeah.
And I do like 2 squares, that's it, at night.
Yeah.
And it's part of my, because there's antioxidants in there.
Yeah.
There's some nutrients in there, stuff like that. So anyway, we'll do another where we're just dedicated to this.
Whole one, because that's literally, I was just talking to someone else about it because we don't hear about this. You don't hear people talking about nutrition anymore.
No, you hear
coaches preaching about it, but parents kind of, it's like in one ear and out the other. They're like, yeah, we're going to McDonald's, you know? So definitely I want to have you on for that because I'm so glad you brought that up. Okay. So
I just want to do a shout out to my man, Nick. He's headed off to Iowa. He's getting ready for the World Cup.
Yeah.
It's
going to be tough.
Out there, you want to support this guy.
Yep.
This is support the United States in general.
Yeah. Hey, right.
We've got a great team.
Yep.
And I think that's on the 9th or something. 9th or 10th.
Yeah. It's coming up this weekend, I believe. Yeah.
Not this weekend.
No. It's next weekend. The next weekend.
Yeah, it's coming up.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. It's like 9th and 10th. Following weekend. You got it.
We'll be in Eau Claire, but we're definitely watching that because I have Greco guys that I talk to that obviously everybody knows freestyle. So I'm trying to kind of keep the Greco thing out in the open for people to pay attention to because it's important. But we do a segment with a guy, Lucas Stelt, out of Blue River, Wisconsin. That's all he does is Greco. But, that's an important event coming up. And I actually just heard some information about the Dan Gable Donnybrook that was down in Iowa at the same venue. They actually test ran, I can't remember what the company is that was running the, track. It's like a track wrestling type of format. And they're trying it out and doing a test run before they put it out for UWWs. And I heard it went pretty bad.
You were talking about this.
Yeah, yeah.
How they had to shut down.
They had to shut down the whole tournament for almost like an hour or two because they transferred the information from track wrestling into this judo style format, which it didn't look like it wouldn't work. But I think the information got crossed and kids had their match changed 5 times. I think there are kids that wrestled each other that shouldn't have. Trial and error kind of stuff, but I mean, obviously when you're dealing with coaches and stuff, they want to get the ball rolling, getting upset, but it's definitely important because it's good to have that back in the U.S. I think it's always been at Iowa, I'm pretty sure, so far. No, Iowa, I think they've had a couple at OSU, but...
About 5 years ago, it was out in L.A.
Yep, correct.
I helped promote it out there in
L.A. Nice, nice.
Yeah.
Okay.
So,
nutrition and another one. I had no idea that you even knew about that stuff. It's fantastic.
It is such an important part.
Huge.
I mean, you just think about it. We just need to be like, we need to be cutting edge with this.
Yeah.
We really do. So, yeah.
I agree.
Open to it. This is, so part of what I've done over the years is that, you know, I focused on different aspects of my acupuncture and healing and different things like that. And I've come circled around to this nutrition and how important it is, along with hydration, along with sleep.
Yeah.
The sleep has been, you know, messed up by some of these kids training all night just to cut weight.
Sure.
Well. Yeah. You can't do that. You really can't do that. It just destroys so many things, abilities that you want to have sharp. Anyway.
Mind blown.
I'm looking to make a difference in the wrestling community any way I can.
Yeah.
I'm in talks with The coach from Michigan as well. And
nice.
And so I'm in talks with the guys up in Stanford, the wrestling team.
Yeah.
And so, and not, you know, not going to happen this year, but maybe in the following years, we'll have somebody that really knows what they're doing, making a big difference.
Yeah.
There's little tweaks. There's these really cool products. Well, like I said,
yep.
Let's talk about that.
Get that on another one. But that's awesome. It's really good. Do you have anything to add?
So did you learn all this through your wrestling process or during the movie and seeing what, because the movie is depicting what, like, mm-hmm. everybody did back then, how they cut weights, yeah, and like, right. that.
So rubber
did you,
suits.
Yeah. Did you sit there and
did that
and like, look at that and we're like, what?
I think you might have been in college at the time actually getting your degree, weren't you?
So I worked, I graduated and from Eastern. I graduated from Coeur d'Alene High School.
Okay.
I didn't wrestle my senior year. I went and played tennis indoors in Spokane and got a yes. tennis scholarship.
Tennis. I almost got him yes. into tennis. I almost got him into that footwork, you know? Yeah.
Tennis is fantastic. I love it just for cardio.
Yeah.
So that's I got great. A scholarship and I went to North Idaho College and then I left and became an iron worker. And because I wanted to be a bodybuilder. So I was bodybuilding for
yes.
5 years.
Yes.
Yes. Bodybuilding for 5 years. So okay. That's where you learn your nutrition. And then I went to Eastern Washington and I was in the athletic training program. I signed up for the athletic training program. So that's where I got all my kinesiology, chemicals, you know, anatomy, okay. physiology. I was on what's called pre-med. You're in a pre-med course.
Okay. Yeah.
And you also have to put 4,000 hours in the athletic training wow. along with your classes.
That's a lot.
And I was also training bodybuilding 3 days on, 1 day off. And I never missed for the 3 years that I was there. I never missed a training session.
Okay.
I wasn't there to party. I was there to make, I made a commitment to, I was going to be.
You're dedicated.
I was going to be on the dean's list, which I was. That's 3.75 or better every semester.
Wow.
And I was dedicated to my athletic, you know, training and my bodybuilding.
So
I went from 185 after, because I trained yeah. 2 years in the Tri-Cities as an iron worker.
Okay.
I hit 185, and then for those two, three years I was at Eastern, I went from 185 to 217.
Holy cow.
Wow. What was your motivation to go from wrestling to tennis to bodybuilding? And in bodybuilding, was there anyone specific that, like, maybe you Absolutely. Wanted to be like?
Absolutely. So I just fell in love with tennis one summer when I was, you know, because in Coeur d'Alene, we did nothing but play tennis all day during the summer. They had out these beautiful outdoor courts there.
Wow.
And
wow.
if I wasn't playing tennis, I was water skiing.
Wow.
In the winter, we were snow skiing. But I loved tennis.
Yeah.
I got into it. I would play like 6 to 8 hours a day.
Wow. Okay.
I just went. So I, wow. So what I, you know, so here's my, you have to understand that the character in Vision Quest isn't a character that was made up. That was who I was at the time. That was how I did my bodybuilding. I was the guy that pushed as hard as I could till I could barely stand. And then I barely walked out of the gym, went home, and just fell in bed and fell asleep.
So you couldn't hold your mud anymore.
Well, I'm going to say something about that in a little bit.
Yeah.
But
yeah. Because I love that line.
I got cast when I was at 217 pounds. I was bodybuilding.
Yeah.
And then it was 2.5 weeks before we started shooting. And I dropped 25 pounds in 2.5 weeks.
Well, that's so not healthy. That's not the way. That's not the nutritional way.
That is not the way.
Whoa.
And so that's why I'm doing this now.
Yeah. Because yeah. You learned.
I was like, I had problems gaining weight. So okay. I was at Eastern Washington and I would just eat up at their food service out there. I had like a yearly subscription, right? So
sure.
I just signed up because it's all you could eat. So I would have
lucky
5 platefuls of food for breakfast. Oh, I would have 5 platefuls.
You were on the bodybuilder diet.
Holy cow.
I was just every ounce of, you know, mm-hmm. calories I could get in.
Yeah.
And if I didn't get in enough, I would put raw, you know, hard-boiled eggs in my pocket and eat them out throughout the day.
Sure.
I would eat six eggs.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, the fact that they stunk up the place because they left them in the locker. So going from 5 platefuls of food at every meal to cut for this, I went down to one meal in the morning, which was 3 egg whites for breakfast.
Sure.
I would have a tuna, a can of tuna on some lettuce with a squeeze of lemon for lunch. And then I would do a 60-minute ride on a stationary bike for dinner.
Wow. How long?
2.5 weeks.
Wow.
I dropped 25 pounds.
Who's your inspiration? And
I was actually at 4% body fat because we I was at 4% body fat.
Wow.
Which is insane, right?
They wouldn't let you compete in Wisconsin.
I know how to do it the wrong way.
Sure.
I absolutely know how to do it the wrong way.
Sure. Yeah, yeah.
And so when you go back, and as your son was saying, it was my inspiration, of course, was Arnold Schwarzenegger, Autobiography of a Bodybuilder by Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Yeah.
Around that front to back, and it was like, I want to get to California. I want to be a bodybuilder. I want to do this for my life.
That's awesome.
You know, but that's when Vision Quest came along.
So they came along, and so you had obviously you were in school, you're in college when they came along. You said you're out in Eastern Washington.
Yeah.
Okay. Where is that university? Obviously Eastern Washington, but what city?
So Cheney, Washington is where Eastern Washington University is located, which is about 15 miles outside of Spokane, Washington.
Okay. So I stayed out for about I went out there twice, but I stayed out in Auburn, Washington. The company that we went to, I did calibration back then, but we went to, they had some storm come through called the Pineapple Express. So it's a Pacific storm that comes up from Hawaii and just slams the coast. And so we had a little bit of rain that night in Auburn, and it was beautiful the next day. But they had power out in the place that we went to, so we got to go around and see all. I mean, talk about beautiful country. Holy cow.
Yeah.
Man, love it out there. So you're in the university. How do you get approached about this movie?
So as an athletic trainer, at different times you're assigned different teams to work with.
Yeah.
So that particular semester, I was assigned to the wrestling team.
Oh, okay.
And so I'm sitting there reading my anatomy book just in the practice room, you know.
Yeah.
And this guy comes in who was on the wrestling team but took that semester off because he was an extra in the movie Vision Quest. He was an extra already.
Okay.
So he and a bunch of guys. All the guys that were wrestling in that were all from Meade. Or from Rogers, and they were all wrestlers. All those extras that were in that wrestling room were all extras.
That's awesome.
State champions.
Yeah.
You look at them, you can tell.
Yep. Yep. For sure.
Rick Thiefault was the guy who came in and sat down, and he was talking about being in the movie. He said, "Hey, I'm getting paid $90 just to roll." And then back in the 80s, that was a lot of money.
Yeah.
You know, hour and a half workout, you get $90.
Yeah. Especially gym rats.
And anyway, so he says, "You know, they're still looking for somebody."
Oh, boy.
So 6 foot tall, muscular build, blonde hair, that can wrestle. He goes, "That's you." And all he says, "You got to go in and check this out." And I'm like, no. I had never done any acting. I wasn't interested.
Sure.
But I was paying for my own education at the time. So I thought, well, okay, let me think about this.
Right.
On the weekend, sometimes I would go and bounce. I was a bouncer at this place called the Slab Inn. You know where I'm talking about.
I did that too, yeah.
So, and I got paid like $30-$40.
Maybe.
It was nothing.
Yeah.
And basically, I did, you know, I break up fights all night. And
it's
like, I just know that one of these times, I'm going to go out in the parking lot, one of these guys are going to be waiting for me with a gun or something. It's like, this is not what I really want.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Anything. Right. So let me go check this out. If I can get a gig as a you know, wrestler in the background and watch and see how movies get made, great. And I get paid for it.
Yep.
Fantastic. Let's do this.
Hell yeah.
No idea the guy had any major role. I didn't know he had lines, none of that. So I agreed to go meet.
Yeah.
You know, the casting director.
So having,
and I had 5 auditions. I ended up having 5 auditions.
Oh, really?
And I had to wrestle a guy at the end. I wrestled a guy at the end that they brought up from Los Angeles.
Okay.
So the last audition was, the director liked me. the producers like this guy that they found in LA. They're like 2.5 weeks between they're starting to shoot this film. They've got to cast this.
You had a wrestle off for the spot?
So we wrestled off.
That's the greatest audition ever. That beats everything. That beats Sylvester Stallone's like he was homeless, he had to do all that. No, wrestle off for it. That should be everything. Whoever wins gets the role.
Oh man. Yeah. So this guy comes up and you guys have this wrestle off. Are you kind of thinking in your head at that point because you're just like you didn't know if you wanted to do it? Were you just
Well, so what they did is they just put us on the mat and I didn't know what we were going to do.
Sure.
So it wasn't like an actual match, but what happened was the coach, you can't do that. But the coach hadn't seen him wrestle. So he had to make sure he could wrestle.
Okay.
So we went out there, we both had our wrestling gear on, we were on the mat and the crew was just sitting there watching, they all surrounded the mat and the coach goes single leg. And I shoot a single leg. He shoots a single double leg, duck under, drag. This, that. So he went back and forth. And then all he goes, okay, good.
That's it.
He says the kid can wrestle. So now it's up to the producers and the directors to make a decision.
Oh boy. Yeah.
And so about 5-10 minutes went by and then John Peters came up to me. He goes, okay, kid, you got the role.
Nice. Nice. And you filled the role really well, man. I mean, because I was just telling Liam this before, watching, and it affirms it even more with you saying that they were wrestlers. You know, the extras and stuff that they had for wrestlers were wrestlers because the matches looked accurate, you know, from the crowd all the way down to the actual wrestling itself. Because I remember as a kid going to watch my brother wrestle when I was little, it was the same thing. You had the cheerleaders on the side with the pillows. Yep. You had the people wearing all the same colors for the schools and stuff like that. So I was just watching it last night and I was like, this is probably one of the more accurate depictions of a wrestling match that I've ever seen in a movie, especially from like the 80s.
Yeah.
You know, and I attributed it to, so like these after school specials, you're coming off the bus, right? You're coming off the bus to go into Thompson High. A lot of times guys, when they're at that last stop of the bus, they'll do that pause, right? And do that look around. And I think it's kind of cheesy. It's an after school special kind of look. You don't. You come out of that bus and you keep cruising down those steps and into that school. It's like, yeah, that sets the mood right there for going in. There's no pause of like, where's my dog coming from or anything like that. It's straight into the school because you're going to wrestle. I guess, so when they ask you, you know, you have to memorize lines. Did they say, hey, here's the script. You got this. You got to do this kind of thing. Were there any kind of instructions or help they gave you with that?
Okay, so kudos goes out to Harold Becker. I think he's passed, unfortunately. He was a great director. He had such an eye for detail. It was insane.
Yeah.
And when we would get ready to shoot a scene, he would walk me through it because I wasn't an actor. And he says, okay, so this is what you're going to do. You're going to walk over here. You're going to pull the paper down. You're going to say you're a bleeder. You're going to turn. You're going to grab, you know. So he walked me through the staging part.
That's cool.
And then he said, and then after that, he just pretty much just said, okay, you got it. I mean, it was like, wow. It was like he knew exactly what he wanted.
Yeah.
It's to give you some idea of the detail that this guy has to have in his, he sees the overall picture, right?
Yeah.
We were wrestling. It was some of the wrestling scenes, and I only show up every now and then when I have a scene.
Sure.
Yep. The rest of the time, it's all Matthew and it's all the rest. You saw it. I only was like throughout the film here and there.
Yeah.
But so I hadn't been there for about 3 days, 3-4 days, and so first thing you do is you show up on set and then you go to makeup and they do your hair and they put your clothes on and, you know, tell you what you're gonna wear for the day.
Yeah.
And you know what scene you're doing. And
yep.
So I done all that and then I came out onto the set and they had the mat out there and then he was shooting the scene over by the where the chairs were so that they had lit that. So they had light it.
Yeah.
Get it all just right.
Yeah.
So they had a break because they shot certain piece. Now they're resetting. He walks over and he's just like kind of watching how things are being set up and making sure. And he looks down and he goes, have you been to hair and makeup yet? And I said, yeah. I said, did they cut your hair? I said, no. He says, go back, have them cut your hair. It's been 4 days.
Wow.
It's been 4 days since I was on set.
Yeah. Yeah, and your hair wasn't fresh enough.
Everything has to match. Everything has to, you know.
Wow.
He could see that there was like 4 days growth in my hair.
Holy cow.
So the detail that this guy has.
Yeah. That's awesome.
And willing to do. So a lot of this has to do with the way Harold saw his vision about how this went.
Yeah.
And then the other big part of this was Cash Stone, which was the guy that was the referee in the final scene. He was the coach for everybody. So he took care of all the wrestlers. He ran the practices. He made sure everything looked right. He and I and another one of his wrestlers actually choreographed the final match.
Really?
So he had a big piece. He was a big part of this.
Yeah, yeah. Well, he's got the knowledge,
What a great guy. He probably was, at the time, he was around 50.
Okay.
When we were doing this. And I showed up for practice, and he had just come running in, you know, with the rest of the guys. They'd done a two-mile run.
Okay.
So this guy's 50 years old. He did a two-mile run, and then puts his hands down, puts his feet up on the wall.
Yeah.
And starts doing handstand push-ups.
Wow.
At 50. It's not like he's like this monster, but you just.
Yeah.
He's like one of these guys that just was always.
Animalistic.
You go to the ends of the earth for him.
Yeah. Yeah. Definitely. Well, on top of seeing that guy do that, then you're like, well, I got to do, you know, I can't not do something, man. I got to step up too. Yeah. Hell yeah. He rose everybody up. That's perfect. So
yeah, it was really great.
So when you're on the set working, so what's that like, Hollywood set kind of people? I mean, obviously I know you guys weren't in Hollywood. You guys were were you in Washington at the time filming that?
Yeah. You know, they shot it mostly. I would say 99% of it was shot in the Spokane area.
Nice.
And at the different schools in that area.
Okay.
Joe Albee Stadium was a stadium that we did this, you know, the log scene in, and
yeah,
and other schools in the local area. So they used all the local kids and all the local schools. What?
Was that log actually heavy or was it a prop?
So it was lightened up a bit.
Understand. I'm sure they probably drilled some holes or something in it, so it's still.
Because, you know, how many times are you going to go up and down this? How many times?
Right.
They shoot from this angle. They shoot it from that angle. They shoot it from a distance.
Well, did they ever tell you, like, hey, that log's real. Don't touch it right now, but that's real. You're going to have to carry that. Did they ever do that? Or were they just
trying
like.
To scare you a little bit?
Or were they just like, oh, it's just a prop. It's all right.
It's okay. Yeah.
So it wasn't. It wasn't like so light that it was like balsa wood. It actually had some thing. And so most recently I did a thing in Auburn and Puyallup for this company called Fitness Quest.
Okay.
And we reenacted some of the scenes with a real log. And I was carrying that log around a lot.
Oh my God.
Picking it up. I had to keep walking through the scene.
Yeah.
And now I'm 64. Okay, wow. I'm 64. Or actually, I'm sorry, I'm 63 now.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I forget too, don't worry.
And so I'm not quite as young and as agile as I used to be, but that log got heavy after we kept picking that thing up.
I can only imagine.
I have carried a log that is a real log.
Yeah.
And like we carried it into there's a few years back I did a fundraiser in Los Angeles, and this guy
Nick Corey
created these logs.
Yeah,
and he sent these shoot logs, sent one of them out.
Yeah,
and I carried it through the crowd, and then they bid on it, they auctioned it off.
Oh, that's cool.
Randy Couture bought it.
Oh, nice.
So that's how special is that? Because
awesome.
He's such a, you know, he's such a beast.
I mean, wrestler, MMA. I mean, yeah, that guy's a dominator.
So did was there anybody on the cast that was like, you had a first impression that maybe wasn't the greatest, almost bad, but wasn't really bad.
First impression concerning impression. Like, did you, when you got on set, was there anybody that you were like, oh boy, like they seem like they're rowdy. Was there a rowdy guy?
No, I mean,
Cooch.
So here it's a kind of a weird setup because I was cast in as an actor.
Okay.
But I'm really a wrestler.
Sure. Sure.
And the actors were looking at me like, oh, he's just a wrestler.
Yeah. Muscle head.
Trying to act.
Yeah.
You know, we actually are actors.
Trying to wrestle.
They didn't say that to me, but I kind of had this, you know, feeling. And then the wrestlers were like, oh, he's got his own like trailer, so he's like this actor. So
wow.
I was kind of like,
yeah,
I was kind of like, my own little world.
Holy cow.
And so I didn't really kind of interact with the wrestlers. I didn't really interact with the actors.
Wow.
And I think that that helped my character because I stayed, you know, in my own world. And so nobody really knew who I was or what I was about.
Sure.
And then when I came on set, then it was just, I was just in character.
But what's crazy though, too, is that, I mean, you were the anti-hero, like you were the person, you were the other one that was being paid attention to besides, I mean, obviously with the scenes, but besides Matthew, yeah. You were like another main character for, so it was almost like you were that, you were the other star besides Matt that had your own spot. You had your own trailer, you had your own, take advantage of that kind of thing. But I'm sure you kind of still wanted to feel like you're part of the, you know, the crowd and the movie kind of thing. But did that really bother you though, being separated like that?
You know, when I took this role on, for me, I just said, I am going to do everything I can to make this role sure. and my character the best role possible. And so when I make a commitment, I'm 100%. Like I said, I dropped 25 pounds in 2.5 weeks.
Yeah.
You know what they said to me? They said, okay, we'd like you to drop a little weight so you're closer to Matthew's weight. And I'm like,
okay.
A little weight? I'm at 217. We're supposed to wrestle at 168. We're doing a hard cut. And we've got to. Otherwise, yeah. This is not going to look, it's not going to look real.
Yeah, right, right, correct. So, well, it's like we were talking about before. When I was watching the video and watching it last night again. I've watched it like 5 gazillion times, but watched it last night and I'm looking at you. I'm like, he's like 184. In here, in the movie, and I was like, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe it's just me seeing something. But actually, you were still pretty big. Like the 168 wasn't the 168.
So then,
and the opposite on the opposite end, Matthew was lifting weights. He had a nutritionist on set.
Yeah,
he was working it out. You know, he quit drinking and quit smoking because he was drinking and smoking as an actor in New York. So he had to completely leave that alone.
Yeah.
He only trained for about 6 months. So the fact that he could pull off a wrestling role after just being you know, engaged in for 6 months, also really impressive.
No wonder why he was a bleeder. He's
yeah,
kind of out of shape, man. Like that stuff will come running out of you. So what were you gonna say? You were gonna ask.
Was Matthew super, like, were you and Matthew really close during, like, after the movie and even a little into the movie? Were you guys kind of, did you guys bond right away or was it kind of?
Or at all.
Yeah.
So during the movie, I had no contact with Matthew other than when I was on set.
Your scenes? Okay.
And I was antagonist to his character. So we didn't even talk. And so.
For a reason. You know, I mean, you're trying to keep it. And like you said, the detail was right. Impeccable. So.
Afterwards, Matthew's a mensch. He's a great guy. It really, and I met his wife, who he's still married to.
Yep.
I mean,
yep.
5 years, 6 years ago, I was out in New York, and we were at Beat the Streets, was doing a big fundraiser.
Yeah, yeah.
Yep. And they had the Russian national team come wrestle the American national team, and they put up a mat at Libby Square.
Yeah. Yep.
And that was about almost 30 years after the movie. And that's the first time I had any contact with Matthew.
Oh,
and
wow.
I sat on the edge of the mat and got to watch these guys
right
the
there.
The
yeah.
And we got to kind of talk a little bit.
Sure.
And
that's cool.
Well, just a great guy.
Yeah.
That's all I can say about him.
Definitely.
Good guy.
Definitely. So you get this movie in. And well, you know, it gets cut, stuff like that. So are they bringing you along for like movie releases and stuff like that? Like, I don't remember how it was back then for movies. I don't remember if there's a lot of you guys going places or red carpet situations, you know?
Yeah. So I was only at the premiere in Spokane. So I didn't go to any of the other things.
Okay.
And, you know, they had Matthew and Carla doing those.
Of course.
So, of course. but what I got to tell you is,
mm-hmm.
We shot for 10 weeks.
Yep.
And then I went back to school and I went back to bodybuilding. And then I got called 3 months later.
Yeah.
And now I'm back after 3 months. I'm just pounding, you know, my body just like loved eating again. Believe me. You know how that goes. Like,
yeah, exactly.
Starving for like 10 weeks. Your body's going, I'm eating everything.
Yeah.
And so I got up to 217. I get a phone call 3 months later, like, oh, we got one more scene to do.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh.
And so, but this time I had 30 days to drop the weight.
Okay.
So I dropped the weight. I got down to 189. And then they flew me to LA. I shot for a week.
Yeah.
And then I went back to school. And I went back to school back to bodybuilding.
Oh, holy
and
cow.
Then they called you again.
Right on.
What?
3 months later.
Holy cow.
I'm not kidding. 3 months later, I'm at 225 because I'm really hitting it. I get a call.
Yeah.
We got one more scene to do.
Oh my God.
And
dude.
Of course I said, tell the producer, or tell Harold, I'm at 225.
Yeah.
And so 5 minutes later I get a phone call. Frank, you got to drop the weight. And I'm like, listen, I've done this twice already.
Yeah.
This is the third time. I'm not going down to 189. I got a bodybuilding contest coming up.
Oh.
I'll go down to 200 pounds.
Yeah, right, right.
So I dropped to 200, and the scene that I did was the one that you're a bleeder.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
And I'm wearing a jean jacket.
Yes.
And if you really look at me, you'll see that I'm a little heavier in that
You look big. The pecs were bigger and everything in there. But I was just looking at, just remembering that scene right now is, you can't, I mean, they did well, you know, they put in the jacket, stuff like that. But I mean, if you knew just paying attention, you could definitely tell there's a difference. That's crazy. That's three of them.
Yeah.
Three.
So I dropped away three times. So I, like they said, I made the commitment and I was like, okay, but you know, it's like, I'll do it. But this is what I can do this time.
Yeah.
And so they agreed to it. And I think that scene really did add something to it.
Hell yeah.
That
was my, like, okay. So I played soccer. I wrestled a lot, you know, middle school, high school, but that wrestling gave me the grittiness for the soccer field. And watching that scene, I had so many comments that I said to guys on the soccer field just because I played physical. A lot of guys asked me why I was such a hard ass. It's just how I played. You know, I like knocking guys. I don't go around guys. I go through guys. Yeah. So watching that scene and watching, like, listening to guys on the soccer field, like, tell me I'm such a hard ass. I'm like, you're a bleeder, dude. Get away from me. Can't hold your mud, man. Get out of here. So that was the always thing that stuck out in my head. And I think I said it to Liam one time because he's only bled once on the mat.
Yeah.
And I think, and I looked at him and was like, don't be a bleeder, dude. We don't need bleeders in the family, man. So this movie comes out, and when it's released, you know, you had to go back and do all this work. I mean, were you telling people about the movie too? Like, hey, go see this movie, or did you just kind of go on doing your thing after that and things happened or didn't happen?
Well, it's for me, it was like, okay, I did what I was supposed to do.
Yeah.
I'm done. Okay. I'm going back to school. I'm going to be, you know, an athletic trainer. Eventually, you know, I'll apply to, you know, PT school and I'll be a physical therapist. That's where I was. That was my trajectory.
Okay.
Yep. And when the movie came out, I got a call. I got a call from New York. This agent in New York said, hey, they premiere. They love the premiere. Love my work. They wanted me to go to LA and get representation. They wanted to represent me.
Okay.
So I had just completed all my coursework for my athletic training. Just completed my 4,000 hours in the athletic training room. I just had my minor to finish, which was, you know, education K-12 as a minor.
Sure.
And so I thought, what an opportunity. How often do you get an opportunity to do something like this?
Yep.
I can come back and finish. Let me go see what this is about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I went to LA. I interviewed with a couple agencies, assigned with one, and then I packed up everything that I owned, put it in what's in my 280ZX, because that's the only thing I really had left over from my ironworking days that I spent money on.
Yeah.
So everything fit in my 280ZX, everything that I owned, and I drove to LA.
Wow.
And my brother was in LA, so luckily I roomed with him. I actually slept in a sleeping bag on the floor in his room.
Yeah.
Until I got my own place. And I started going to acting classes because I'd never done any acting.
Sure. Yep.
And so I enrolled in acting classes from Monday through Thursday from 6 to midnight.
Okay.
And I did that for a year. And then I found another instructor that did from Monday through Friday from 6 to midnight or 1 o'clock or whenever a.m. in the morning we finished.
Yeah, yeah.
And I did that for another 2 years. I got a few other roles. I did another movie. I did a commercial, national commercial. I did a TV show. And then I did the live action show up at Universal Studios. So I
Working
up there for 2.5 years at Universal Studios, and what's called it was in the Conan show.
Oh, really?
Right.
Holy shit, that's cool. Nice.
So here's a little fun facts.
Yeah.
A couple of the guys that I was working with.
Yeah.
The guy that plays in Halloween.
Yeah.
and plays the murderer.
Michael Myers.
Michael Myers.
Yeah.
That was one of the guys I worked with at up at the.
Oh, really?
Nice.
James Courtney.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, James Courtney.
Another one of the guys that was up there, it was one of the actors that actually played Conan.
Yeah.
Was a guy named Bill Birmingham.
Okay. I've heard of him.
Who's on Yellowstone.
Yep. Correct. Yeah. One of my favorite shows. Can't even explain to you how much I love that show.
Okay, there you go.
Two.
So, you know, came out of that. And then also Ron Howard. Ron Howard was in there. He played on Cobra Kai, and he's now on Cobra Kai series. He was on Conan's. Yeah. So a lot of people came out of that.
Nice. Really interesting. So the end of the movie comes around, and obviously, I mean, it's a cult classic, especially within the wrestling world in general. But nothing ever got presented to you as far as, hey, we saw you in this wrestling movie or anything like that. But nobody reached out to as far as to, I don't know, the director from that movie for anything else. Once they were done, they were gone. They packed up and left.
You know, this is kind of how things go. Like, as long as you're needed and wanted, you're like the king. And then when you're done, you're just like, that's it.
But it sounded like it was pretty decent. I mean, a smooth thing for you. You went and did it. And obviously the whole three times afterwards wasn't very fun. But ending up with, a pretty goddamn good movie. I mean, I'm not going to lie. Like I said, the accuracy, how things looked. I mean, just the way you guys acted was perfect too. Cause I can see these guys doing that in the hallway with each other.
Yeah.
You know, it was awesome. So where do you, like, when you're done with college and things like that, when does this all start to come up again? Was it Beat the Streets? Was that when it was?
My reconnection back to the college, or back to wrestling, actually, Beat the Streets kind of like brought me out to LA, to New York for that. Mm-hmm. And then my friend, Scott Glab, who was actually one of the wrestlers in the wrestling room at Eastern Washington.
Oh, really?
Nice. Moved to Santa Ana, began coaching at Santa Ana High School.
Okay.
If you ever want to read an amazing book, it's called The Saint in the City. By Scott Glab.
Okay.
And it's about his story going to this, school where their wrestling team was the last, I mean, the very bottom of the CIF. I mean, they barely even could field a team to show up that would then get slaughtered. His first match, I think he lost 72-0 or something like that.
Wow.
I mean, he just got destroyed.
I want to read that. For sure.
28 years he worked with these kids. I mean, it's an amazing story. And after he'd been there long enough, he created a community and a wrestling program. They became powerhouses out there at the CIF. They would win and or take second. He's had national champions. He's had state champions. He's got women that were champions. He's written a book about it, and each chapter is about one of the kids that he had coaching.
I'm reading it,
and
then I'm gonna have him on.
Anyway, so
that's awesome. That was,
he reached out to me and said, "Hey Frank, why don't you come down and hand out medals and things like that at this tournament?"
Hell yeah!
And I was like, okay. I had gotten my master's degree in Oriental medicine. My wife had been running a clinic for like 27 years.
Yeah.
And that's when he reached out, and that's when it started to kick up again, because after that, then U.S. Wrestling reached out and said, "Would you help promote the World Cup we're having out here?" And I said, "Absolutely."
And
promote wrestling, and that's when I came up with the T-shirts.
Yeah,
because I figured, like, if I'm going to be there promoting, let's have something that we can sell. Have something to talk about.
So yada, yada. Then the next question I have is, when are you going to come out with a line that actually represents the school that your character went to?
Yeah. Hoover.
The big old H. The big old H. I mean, don't get me wrong, Thompson High is great, but you didn't go there.
I know. Well, I was in the process. I had signed with a company two, 3 years ago. And this company started making some sweatshirts and then started making some fight shorts, and then we had a jersey that we had made up as well.
Yeah,
and we were headed down that road, and then the company kind of lost its well, actually they did so well they got sold to Spartan. Spartan race, and Spartan's taking them over, and they just like cut away all this other stuff that we were doing.
Yeah,
so I just kind of let that go at that point, but
yeah,
somewhere down the road, you know, you just have to be careful because
you do
licensing stuff.
I agree. We talked. Yeah. Oh. It's like I said, I don't like to, people put work into the stuff, you know, they put whatever they did and they got it monetized or copywritten. I don't want to mess with that because that's not my work, but no, that's cool. So the movie comes along, all this grows. I mean, you've been all over the place now. I've seen you at tournaments. I just, a lot of times, so I don't get me wrong, I get starstruck, but I also went out to LA and like, so my brother-in-law is friends with Peter Dante. And so he kind of told me a story of, they went to a bar one night, a small bar, and actually it was in LA, but the Buffalo Bills quarterback parents at the time owned the bar. And he's like, I always brought him here. We would come here just to hang out, low key, kind of hole in the wall. But if you've seen any of Adam Sandler's movies, you know who Peter Dante is, and you know that he played the quarterback. So people see him. And they would just walk behind him and just be like, hey, dude, can I shake your hand? Can I shake your hand? He doesn't want to deal with that. Like, he wants to just be out and have a night, right? So he told me about that. He goes, there's one night where he got upset, you know, just like, oh man. So from that point on, listening to that, I was like, I'm not just walking up to dudes, just acting like, oh my God, I love you. I don't do that. If you got people around you, I'm going to give you space and I'm just going to let it happen. I know I'm going to run into you eventually because we wrestle enough and I know now it's going to happen, but I've seen you at tournaments. I've seen you, you know, you either have your shirts or maybe you have like posters along or something like that to sign. I mean, do you find yourself kind of like, well, okay, I think this is kind of good. And especially now knowing the nutrition part that you have you ever found yourself kind of maybe wanting to like take it in another direction? Like, is that possibly kind of what you're doing? Are you going to write it all out and just kind of keep it going with the way that I'm not going to argue with you. Cause I love it.
Yeah. So, you know, I can't tell you how many times I'm like, okay, let's just put this baby to bed. We had a good run.
Yeah.
It's now been 37 years. I've gotten so many great responses on Facebook and Instagram from coaches, from people, from wrestlers, from parents.
Yeah.
That it had a very powerful impact in their life. One guy said, that's the reason I became a wrestler. Okay. You know who Cameron Guerin is?
Yes, I do. He may not.
Okay. So Cameron Guerin is a perfect example. Mm-hmm. She said she didn't know what she wanted to do as an athlete, and her parents didn't know what she wanted to do. Then she watched Vision Quest, and she told her parents, I want to be a wrestler.
Yeah.
That's when she decided. And then same thing, you know, Nick, the reason I'm working with Nick is that he also, his parents put Vision Quest on 3 or 4 times a week, every week. I mean, they were like,
You're lucky I don't do that right now. That's kind of where I'm at.
Yeah. You'd be like, okay.
Yeah.
Get off your TikTok and come watch Vision Quest.
Watch this, man.
But anyway, and there's been military personnel that have said, hey, this has gotten me through our tours. And it's like, it got me through Citadel. All these people that have reached out, I just feel the love from, and I see that it still is important to them.
Yeah.
Me personally, I want to use this platform to take it to the next level and start talking about nutrition and like make this a focus.
Yeah.
And if I can use this as a way to do that,
do it.
And especially since Nick is, you know, just killing it.
Yeah.
That he, you know, I have like, okay, this stuff works.
Yeah.
It actually works. And you can look at what the outcome is. If you actually think about doing this the right way,
yeah,
you can have, this is next level of energy, endurance, strength, fitness, speed, all of that.
Yeah.
By eating right and the right nutrition. And because everybody is different.
Yep.
Because they're as different outside as you are inside.
Yeah.
So if I'm going to offer something to you, it's going to be different than what me am going to. And because there's an age difference. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
But his microbiome is completely different. His nutritional needs will be different than yours. There will be some overlap, of course.
Sure.
But this is where I get into, like, just as important as what you give somebody is how much you give them.
I totally agree. I think
everything.
The trajectory that you're taking with it, I think is smart. I think, you know, you have a face, you have a voice already with the Vision Quest and being able to, your intelligence that you have behind this, that I'm hearing already is just, I mean, that's only going to help. And if you keep it going and you're able to implement it through like a couple, just a couple of colleges, it's going to be huge. Because those kids, and we're just talking about this within the state itself, those kids then are going to go back to their home states, maybe turn into coaches or get clubs going of their own. And they're going to take that knowledge that they've gotten from you and then spread that. And I think it's only going to benefit because obviously from where you and I came from in wrestling with rubber suits, spitting, throwing up, all that other stuff, they've eliminated it. Obviously, the the organizations realize it's not healthy, correct? But there's another step that they need to go through, and that I think if they start to implement, and just hearing what you're talking about, like I said, we're going to gear up and talk to you more because this is going to be something I think that obviously I dropped 65 pounds in about, I want to say 3 months or so. So yeah. I was calorie counting, 2,500 calories I was doing a day. I'm 43 years old. I was at 240 pounds. That was gross. Mm-hmm. Like, mm-hmm. I hated it. So I kind of implemented what these guys do already in the wrestling room. I'm wearing a sweatshirt at work because I ran a bender at that time, CNC machines. So mm-hmm. I'm changing tooling. I'm wrenching and I'm grabbing, tooling that weighs more than, he does probably off a shelf to be able to put it onto something else. So I'm sweating, but I'm eating the calories at the same time. But dropping that 65 pounds was probably the easiest that I did because I still ate, and I wasn't eating candy. I like my Reese's peanut butter cups, don't get me wrong, but I wasn't eating Skittles and candy constantly. I was eating chicken salads. I was, I was consuming still like rice and spaghetti, things like that. But instead of using the normal plate, I grabbed that small little tea plate and that's what I was putting my food on, portions. And so I kept telling him that too, because right now he's going through the whole thing of, I don't know if I'm going to take it easy on food for the next day or two and stuff like that. It's like, yeah, but you're close. You're still going to have two workouts left yet. Make sure you're still eating something and hydrate. For God's sakes, hydrate. That's the one thing kids don't do that I noticed a lot of is the hydration. And that's, to me, is big. But you and I are going to dive. We're in an hour. We're going to dive into that some more.
I mean, I feel like we just got started.
I know. I have a lot more questions. I have a lot more that I want to ask about the movie too, but yeah, I definitely wanted to be able to sit down with you for a while. And now you're coming back on. I had no idea that you dove into nutrition. I actually listened to a podcast that you had from about 2 years ago, I think it was, with two young guys. And I heard you mention something about nutrition. I was like, I knew it. There had to have been something different with what you had going on in life. I was like, because he can't just be riding on Shute. He seems way too smart for that, So then when I heard that, I was like, aha, he does.
So I'm going to leave you with one little teaser because I didn't talk anything about this, but for the last 2 years, I've been working with a producer, a guy named Michael Gray out in New Jersey.
Yes.
You know who he is?
I've heard, yes. Sure do.
Good guy. Very, very, very good guy. He's really got some great projects in his producing back portfolio.
Yep.
And so over 2 years ago, we talked about writing a sequel, not a sequel, but a Vision Quest series, which we wrote. So we've got the pilot, we've got the episode, we've got the Bible.
Yeah.
It's been well received. We'll kind of like punch it up again at the beginning of the year and try and find a place for it. If that happens, it would be one of the most amazing things, I believe, for the wrestling community.
You have no idea. That would be killer.
How cool would that be? It'll be very similar to the Cobra Kai concept, like 30 years later, what's happened?
Yeah.
What happened? We answer the question, how come Shute lost? How did he possibly lose against... There's some background information.
We cannot wait.
Got some other stuff that's written in there as well about, Loudon Swain's life and his trial.
Yeah.
Because we both have demons, but it's all going to kind of center around.
Oh, man. Am I the first one you told that?
No, I've shared this before, but it's like we kind of kept it in wraps for so long, and now I'm just going to put it out there
because
we've had it out there long enough.
That's
where
so
we
cool,
know
dude.
What we want to do, and we're just looking for specific pieces that we need, a specific showrunner, a specific director, before we can really kind of take it to the next level.
Well, I wouldn't mind playing an extra. You guys can make me a towel boy. I wouldn't mind. I'm going out wiping the mat down.
I'll do it.
stuff like that. But that's awesome. Liam, that's really cool.
We're high school wrestlers, so you know.
Yeah.
We'll be trying to pull in wrestlers.
Yeah.
That are actually wrestlers.
Hell yeah. That's so cool. I'm so glad that you guys thought of doing that, because I think a lot of people are out there asking, is there going to be a sequel? And you think in your head, they gotta, but you know,
they've tried several times. It just hasn't really come together. I know a company that actually presented their remake.
Okay.
Of Vision Quest, and Warner Brothers said, now we don't like it.
Yeah.
So it's been tried a few times. We're hoping that this is going to be the window where we can get this, because everything, what 80s right now, retro is pretty goddamn cool.
It's
right now
coming back. I see kids rolling their pants up. Mullets are here again, you know, and mullets and mustaches are making their way through. So it's going to be great.
I was just about to ask you if you're going to do any other acting things or anything like that.
So there you go.
Boom. That's drops the bar right on you.
That's awesome. Well, Frank, I appreciate you sitting down with us, and you are coming back on, dude. I'm going to end this out, and you and I are going to talk a little bit more just about nutrition stuff here, because there's questions I have for him and for me. I have my wife will benefit from it too. But everybody, this has been Frank Jasper, AKA Shute from the Vision Quest movie. Me, Liam, Frank, we are out. All of our episodes are brought to you by Appleton Tattoo, located at 117 South Appleton Street in Appleton, Wisconsin, right off the main drag on College Avenue. You can't miss them. I've had some work done. I have a Celtic cross that covers my back that was done by Jason. We're not done yet. Jason Winans and crew, the artists that he have there, those guys are the best in the Fox Valley. They are definitely one to go to if it's something that you've just been kind of throwing around. They'll make you feel comfortable. It's a very clean environment, very nice crew, and very willing to get done whatever you need done when you need it done. You can message them on Facebook. I know they're on Facebook. You can give them a call at 920-604-8289 and get in touch with Jason Winans and crew at Appleton Tattoo, located again in Appleton, Wisconsin at 117 South Appleton Street. Right in Appleton. Very flexible hours, great crew, clean environment again. I would not send you anywhere else except for these guys. Appleton Tattoo.